First of all, I'd like to thank the people and organizations that made tonight possible. First of all, Young America's Foundation, through whom which we were able to obtain Mr. D'Souza. Mr. Larry Lindsay, who funded the Lindsay Lecture Fund, as well as the SAFC, who provided tonight. And Mr. Nate Heinz and the Student Activities Office for their immense support every step of the way. And our advisor, Professor Gene Yarbrough. My name is Francisco Navarro. I am the co-chair of the College Republicans, along with Jack Lucy, somewhere over there. And the topic of tonight's lecture is something I reflect upon a lot. I am a first-generation American. My parents left Cuba in the 1960s due to communism. My father's family settled in Louisiana, my mother's side in Florida, Miami. After losing everything, just created a new life. On the plane ride to their new life, my grandfather told my father that Castro took everything away, but the only thing they couldn't take away was their education. So with that and a work ethic, they imprinted upon a path that that led their lives and many sacrifices that I am very grateful for, that have shaped many ways who I am. However, my story is not unique to this country. In many ways, it's the story of everybody in this room. Whether you trace your lineage to the Mayflower or you're only a few years removed from another country, somebody at some point decided to make your future the purpose of their lives. Whether you're Irish, Italian, Colombian, Chinese, or Nigerian, somebody came to this country for that opportunity. I am only one generation removed from that reality, so it's very vivid to me. We're in a very divided time in our country, to use one of the words that could be used. There's several tensions, and a word that is frequently thrown out is that of privilege. And I would like to one form of privilege that is rarely talked about is that of American privilege. A privilege that it's so easy to take for granted. As we look upon the world, we see the plight of Venezuela, the constant disarray in the Middle East. And I encourage us to remember and be grateful for that American privilege. My parents lost their country. I'm not losing this one. And with that, it's a privilege to introduce our speaker for tonight. Born in Mumbai, India, Dinesh D'Souza came to the U.S. as an exchange student and graduated Phi Beta Kappa from Dartmouth College in 1983. Dinesh has had a 25-year career as a writer, scholar, and public intellectual. A former policy analyst in the Reagan White House, D'Souza also served as a John M. Olin Fellow at the American Enterprise Institute and the Robert and Karen Rishwan Fellow at the Hoover Institution at Stanford University. He served as the president of King's College in New York City from 2010 to 2012. Called one of the top young public policymakers in the country by Investors Business Daily, D'Souza quickly became known as a major influencer in public policy through his writings. His first book, Illiberal Education, publicized the phenomenon of political correctness in America's colleges and universities and became a New York Times bestseller for 15 weeks. It has been listed as one of the most influential books of the 1990s. In addition to his publications, he's become a renowned filmmaker with his top-grossing documentaries, 2016 Obama's America, America, Imagine a World Without Her, and his most recent film, Hillary's America, which is somewhere available for purchase here. Mr. D'Souza has been named one of America's most influential conservative thinkers by the New York Times Magazine. The World Affairs Council lists him as one of the nation's 500 leading authorities on international issues, and Newsweek cited him as one of the country's most prominent Asian Americans. One of D'Souza's favorite venues for debates and speeches has been college campuses. During the past 20 years, he has appeared at hundreds of colleges and universities and has spoken with hundreds of thousands of students in those live settings. And now, please join me in welcoming Mr. D'Souza.
Thank you very much. I'm Delighted to be here. I should say delighted to be back. I was at Bowdoin almost 10 years ago, and I'm thrilled to be here. I went to college a couple of hours from here at Dartmouth, and my daughter is actually there now. We visited yesterday, so we've had a very pleasant weekend leading up to me coming to Bowdoin. And what a time this is to have a talk on American politics. This is the most surreal election that I've seen in my lifetime. And we have two extremely bizarre, mercurial, exasperating, almost intolerable candidates running on both sides. And I think for the young person of principle, it's a baffling question about how to think about all this. And this question is made even more difficult by the fact that on many campuses, I would say even most, the underlying issues that are critical to this election are never publicly discussed by either candidate. And so, for example, we have heard, and by the president, we have heard so far for 8 years, the almost repetitive chant that people should pay their fair share. But not once have I heard anyone in public life ever specify what the fair share actually is. If one purports to be a liberal, let's say you think that the 39.5% top tax rate is insufficient, and you think it should be more, you have some burden of saying whether it should be 50 or 70 or 90. In other words, of the liberal, it is always reasonable to ask, in what society would you be a conservative? In what society would you be fine with the way the tax rate is now and not push for more fair share? I notice that this question is never answered. In fact, what is never answered is even, what is a conservative? If you were to look at public life to see what conservatives are trying to conserve, the answer is obscure. Meanwhile, if you think of yourself as a progressive, and somebody were to ask you, what do you mean by progress? Progress toward what? In what direction? You're hard-pressed to know the answer. I've never heard anyone give a clear, succinct answer to that question either. I will say that I come at American politics somewhat from the outside as much as from the inside. I remember quite vividly when I was 17 years old and I first saw the United States through the foggy lens of an airplane window. I saw the skyline of New York. I saw the Statue of Liberty. And I remember even then that strange sensation that my life from that moment on would be totally different. I felt that I was moving from the margin of the world to the center. And I thought that if I stayed in America, I would be able to be the architect of my own destiny in a way that would be inconceivable, not just in India, but pretty much any place else. In other words, for me, the American dream was not merely a dream of opportunity, get rich, make it, but rather the chance to be in the driver's seat of your own life, to be the maker, the choreographer of your own future, to have a destiny not given to you but constructed by you. My wife, Debbie, who's here, is an immigrant from Venezuela. Both of us believe that the United States represents ladders of opportunity that enable the guy who's starting out at the bottom, I came to the United States, $500 in my pocket, to better your life and take control of your life. And our politics is based on that. Which is the party in America that protects the ladder of opportunity? Because if you think about it, the rich guy does well anywhere in the world. In fact, if you're really rich, you can get benefits in other countries that you could never get in America. There's a social egalitarianism in America that moderates the prerogative of wealth. even though Bill Gates is a really rich guy, he can't walk around the United States and offer people $100 to kiss his feet. No one would really do it because people don't think that he's better than they are, no matter how much more money he might have. But a country to me is judged not by the wealthy guy, but by the ordinary guy. What is the best way for the ordinary guy to make a better life for himself or herself? Now, my experience in America has, for 25 years, including when I was last here at Bowdoin, was shaped by, I would say, American intellectual life. I was a policy analyst in the Reagan White House. I was at the American Enterprise Institute, the Hoover Institution at Stanford. I've written 15 books. And so I lived in this rarefied world of looking at American politics as a debate between two sides, two rival ideologies, the Republicans, the Democrats, the conservatives, the liberals. And that point of view was completely shaken when about a year and a half ago, I found myself staring through, you might say, prison bars, locked up by the US government. In other words, I literally was standing in a courtroom and I hear a bailiff shout out, United States of America versus Dinesh D'Souza. And the full import of that sunk into me, and I realized that I had actually come to a country that was now legally, officially against me. Now, I should tell you my crime. I had never previously donated to a political campaign, but a longtime Dartmouth friend of mine was running for the US Senate in New York. It was a quixotic campaign. She had no chance to win. It was against a virtually invincible opponent. But because we'd been pals for 25 years, I wanted to help her, and I gave her $20,000 more than the campaign finance limit. I exceeded the campaign finance limit. Now, I didn't tell her about it. She didn't know, and I wasn't trying to get anything out of it. There was no corruption committed or alleged. Interestingly, no American has ever been locked up for doing what I did. None. But in this case, the Obama Justice Department went against me full tong, and I was sentenced to 8 months in a confinement center on the Mexican border under the supervision of the Bureau of Prisons of the Obama administration. Now, this experience was very eye-opening for me. It was eye-opening for me because it showed me a totally different side of America. All kinds of people whose American dream is totally broken. I was exposed to predominantly Hispanics. Interestingly, this confinement center wasn't white-collar criminals. It was the whole gamut. Because in today's America, if you go to prison, let's say you serve 10 years for armed robbery, after about 9.5 years, they'll send you to a confinement center for 6 months to transition into society. So we had rapists, armed robbers, drug smugglers, coyotes, the whole group. And for me, this was kind of a scary place because I thought to myself, wow, everybody seems to be in a group or a gang. Even the Hispanics, who were the majority, were in multiple gangs. The American Hispanics are called Southsiders. They had a bunch of gangs. And then there were the Mexicans, and they had their gangs. I mean, I consider the idea of starting my own gang, the Asian Indian gang, but didn't really want to be the sole member. Well, after a while, I began to listen to these guys think and talk and try to assimilate their view of the world. I'm going to call it the ideology of the criminal underclass. And their ideology, very interestingly, is that human life is motivated by a few simple, elemental impulses. In fact, as I would lie in my bunk bed at night and listen to people talk, I realized that they only talked about four things: food, sleep, money, and sex. That's it. And I thought to myself initially, wow, these are people of such low, limited horizons. These are people who will never discuss what Socrates said in the streets of Athens, for example. They have no interest in it. But then I also realized that their view is that there are primal, elemental impulses that drive human nature. Human beings want things, and they do things because they want things. And I realized that I had looked at American politics as though this were not the case. In other words, I looked at American politics as if it were a kind of debating society, in which the Republicans stand up and proclaim the virtues of liberty, and then the Democrat stands up and proclaims the virtues of equality. And then the Republican stands up and talks about equality of rights, and then the Democrat stands up and talks about equality of outcomes. And then I realized, but isn't human nature, in fact, just as these guys think, motivated in part by acquisitiveness and greed and lust and hatred and envy and revenge? And if those are the actual motives of human nature, is it possible to even begin to understand American politics by subtracting those qualities out, by pretending that this is just about two rival views of a better America? In other words, what I want to do today is talk a little bit, not just about American politics the way people say it ought to be, but let's look at American politics as it really is. Let's listen less to what people say and look more at what they want. This is nothing more than an application of the dictum of Machiavelli, in which he says that in the past, thinkers have looked at the world as they imagine it to be. But he, Machiavelli, will for the first time see the world as it actually is. And that's what I want to do tonight. Look a little bit at American politics as it actually is. And in that sense, I want to dig a little bit beneath the Trump phenomenon, although I'll say a few words about Trump and what he represents as well. I want to start by talking a little bit about the Democratic Party, because in researching this movie, Hillary's America, and an accompanying book, I was a little startled at what I discovered about the Democratic Party. And I say this because, as a Dartmouth grad, as someone who's lived in politics most of my life, we have the self-image of the Democratic Party. It was on full parade in Philadelphia. We've seen it ever since. The Democratic Party is the party of the little guy. It's the party of the ordinary man. It's the party of Latinos and blacks. It's fought for civil rights. It delivered the civil rights movement of the 60s. It's the party of women. It's been a champion of women. So the Democrats are now what they've been, and that is they have been the party of the outsider. The Republican Party is, in a sense, the party of the insider. And I myself kind of thought that was true. In fact, I would sometimes make jokes about it. One time I was at Harvard a few years ago, and I was speaking to the South Asians at Harvard, and one of the young women, born in America but of Asian Indian descent, talked about the great difficulty, which all immigrants know, the difficulty of feeling in that no man's land where you are between two countries, not fully belonging to either. You've left your own country and you're no longer Indian, but you don't really know if you're American. You're on a tightrope between two buildings. And so what this girl was asking me was, she said, "Mr. D'Souza, how will I know when I have become an American?" And I said, "You'll know you've become an American when you become a Republican." And I was being sort of facetious, but as you can see, my quip reflected this idea of the Republican Party as the insider party and the Democratic Party as the party hospitable to the outsider. Now, interestingly, digging into America's political history, I was somewhat startled to realize that many of the things that I had taken for granted were not really true. I mean, for example, I thought that the Civil War was a war between the anti-slavery North and the pro-slavery South. Now, I knew, of course, that there were Southerners who didn't own slaves. In fact, I knew that a majority of Southerners did not own slaves, and a majority of Confederates did not own slaves. But what I didn't know, or well enough, is that the Democratic Party in the North protected slavery with the same cunning zeal as the Democratic Party in the South. In other words, the secession debate was between the North and the South, yes. But the slavery debate prior to the Civil War was not between the North and the South. It was between the pro-slavery Democratic Party, North and South, and the anti-slavery Republican Party. Now, this was worth digging into and learning more about. And so I thought to myself initially, Dinesh, this is a very sort of stark conclusion. surely, as with so many things, and here we're talking about slavery, an institution that goes back to the dawn of mankind, there's a lot of blame to go around. Surely, for example, there were Republicans who owned slaves, and so I tried to find some. And then it hit me that in 1860, the year of the Civil War, no Republicans owned slaves. All the slaves in the entire country were owned by Democrats. Now, I state this in the movie, and it's a very interesting sight because for 3 months there has been an unbelievable thrashing around to prove this single statement wrong. And it's actually, it is a statement that qualifies as a scientific statement because you can easily prove it wrong by just giving me a list of 10 Republicans who owned slaves. But no one's able to do it because there weren't 10. Someone thrashed around and told me that Grant inherited a slave, but this actually happened to be when Grant was a Democrat. So we don't need to argue over Grant, but my point is the fact that people have to fight at this level shows you that there is a stark overall truth to what I'm saying that is actually not known by even people who have a very good education and are completely immersed in American history and American politics. So after the Civil War, the Democratic Party was in ruins, and so it had to reconstitute itself. And so it built itself along a single major theme, and that theme is white supremacy. White supremacy was the governing doctrine of the Democratic Party in the post-war period. And this white supremacy is defined by the fact that the Democrats passed every segregation law in the South. Democratic governors signed it, and Democratic officials carried it out. And it was the delegate of the DNC, Nathan Bedford Forrest, who started the Ku Klux Klan. Now, interestingly, the Republicans shut down the Klan almost immediately with a series of acts called the Ku Klux Klan Acts of 1871. But the Klan was revived in the early 20th century when progressive Democrat Woodrow Wilson showed a pro-Ku Klux Klan movie in the White House to the cabinet, no less. And this inspired a Klan revival not only in the South, but in the Midwest and the West. If one were to make a list of all the grand dragons and grand wizards and kleagles of the Ku Klux Klan, 99% of them are Democrats. And virtually every American lynched by the Ku Klux Klan in the United States has been lynched by a Democrat. This is true. And then we fast forward a little bit to the civil rights movement of the 1960s, which I thought was by and large done by the Democratic Party because, of course, it was Lyndon Johnson who is generally attributed to be the guy who pushed through the Civil Rights Act of 1864. Well, what I didn't know was, A, more Republicans proportionately voted not only for the Civil Rights Act of 64, but the Voting Rights Act of 65 and the Fair Housing Bill of 68 than Democrats did. The main opposition to the civil rights movement came from the Democratic Party. If the Democratic Party was the only party in Congress, no Republicans, none of these laws would have passed. None of them. And so the question then becomes, what's going on? Why don't we all know all this? And when I would raise this issue with scholars, they would say, oh yes, Dinesh, well, now that you mention it, these things are true, but you need to know that there was a big switch. The two parties in the 1960s, on racial grounds, switched sides. It's kind of like saying that in the 1960s, the cops all became robbers and the robbers all became cops. Even if you didn't get the memo, that's supposedly what happened politically. And I thought, well, that's implausible on the face of it, but is that really true? And the beauty of these kinds of claims, like the big switch, is they are very easy to check. Now, on the face of it, the big switch is supported by two pieces of data that are impossible to deny, and nor would I try to. One, blacks who used to be Republicans are now today Democrats. Number two, white Democrats in the South, many of them did move to the Republican Party and are Republicans today. So there actually has been this political migration. But this migration has nothing to do with race. If it did, you would expect that blacks would have become Democrats in the 1960s or in the post-1960s. But in fact, blacks became overwhelmingly Democrat in the 1930s. Now, in the 1930s, the Democratic Party was the party of segregation and the Ku Klux Klan. So for some reason, blacks left the party of Lincoln and emancipation, the party that had actually implemented the 13th, 14th, and 15th Amendments. Think of it, the right, not only freedom from slavery, but the right to vote and equal rights under the law. The whole civil rights movement was based upon these constitutional amendments, which, by the way, were not only passed by the Republican Party, they were passed by the Republican Party against virtually 100% Democratic opposition. For example, no Democrat voted for the 14th Amendment. No Democrat voted for the 15th Amendment. I'm talking about zero. So what we're talking about here is that you have this sort of Republican Party which had delivered for African Americans, and yet why would they become Democrats and join, as I say, the party of segregation and the Klan? And the answer is the economic benefits of the New Deal at a very hard time in which survival itself was at stake. And when did white Republicans, why did white Democrats in the South become Republican? By and large, it was a trend that began in the 60s but accelerated in the 70s and really was consummated in the 80s, in the Reagan era. Now, most of you are too young to know the Reagan era, but Reagan's appeal was not to race. Reagan's appeal was to patriotism, it was to free markets, it was to privatization, deregulation, anti-communism. This was the agenda that pulled the South to the Republican Party. So what about Nixon's Southern strategy? There was no Southern strategy. In fact, Nixon didn't win the South. The Deep South went to Wallace, who was a Democrat and was running as an independent. Nixon won the Upper South. Now, the point I want to make is this. As the South became less racist, it became more Republican. You can almost draw those opposite lines through the 20th century to see this great shift in American history. Now, say a word about women. The Democratic Party was the party of opposition to women's suffrage. It fought it for 30 years. It blocked it in the House and the Senate. Eventually, the Democrats were defeated in the Republican Congress. And so the Democrats fought it in the states, where they lost again. And so women's suffrage politically delivered by the Republican Party. Now, let's jump forward to today, because someone is going to say, well, wait a minute. What are you saying, Dinesh? Okay, the Democratic Party is the party of this history of bigotry. But what about now? Well, first of all, even if we were talking about now, we're in an academic setting. There would be no reasonable person in this room, I don't think, who wouldn't agree that the past has a decisive impact on the present, that present-day conditions are shaped by things that happened before. If the Democratic Party really is the party of slavery and segregation and anti-women's suffrage and the Ku Klux Klan and lynching and opposition to civil rights, wouldn't you expect some kind of public acceptance or admission of this? Interestingly, the Democratic Party has never admitted its role. It's never taken responsibility for it. It's never apologized for it, and it's never paid one penny in restitution for it. Never. In fact, in an unbelievable sleight of hand, the blame is always foisted onto someone else. In the case of the slavery, it was the South. The South is to blame. In the case of many of the other crimes of American history, it was the white man. It was America. America did this. America did that. Well, if America did it, presumably it would still be going on. Some Americans did it, and other Americans stopped them. So we need a somewhat more precise accounting of American political history. Now, I say all this because, to me, this is the essential backdrop of trying to understand our situation now. Because the first question I ask is, if what I've said this evening is true, how is it that it is not broadly known? Am I the only guy who's figured this stuff out? Obviously not. The problem, as I see it, is that many things in American public life are said to be true, but are not true. But the reason they're believed to be true is because the political left dominates the three biggest megaphones of our culture: academia, Hollywood, and the media. These are mutually reinforcing. One guy puts out a study, it's then reported in Time magazine, it's then picked up on BuzzFeed, it's then reported on CBS News, it's then amplified by comedians, and there's an unbelievable disproportion of forces in these two sides. I mean, so many of you know, you get political quips and a sense of humor, but also news from guys like Bill Maher, Colbert, Jon Stewart. Who are the Republican alternatives to those guys? Basically, it's nobody, nobody, and nobody. So as a result, there is a one-sidedness to the flow of information. And so the problem with that is that if somebody's putting out something that's wrong, false, even propaganda, even disinformation, it doesn't matter if you or I know differently. We don't have a megaphone. We don't have a way to shout out or counter this information being put out there. This is actually a little bit why I changed my own career. I was, as I say, a think tank guy, an author, a speaker. The last time I came to Bowdoin, that's what I was. And then I pivoted to make movies. Well, oddly enough, I got the idea from Michael Moore. I remembered he had made Fahrenheit 9/11. He dropped it in the middle of the 2004 campaign. I thought, if that guy can do it, how hard can it be? And so, but my real goal, I mean, my objective was to build a megaphone so that I would be able to put information out there. I mean, even if a book is number one in the New York Times bestseller list, that's 100,000 copies. That's a lot of people. But Hillary's America, my movie, out in the theaters, has been seen by 1.5 million people in the theater. Probably another 1.5-2 million people will see it in DVD. Suddenly, you're able to get information out to a substantially larger group of people. But it seems to me very destructive to our democracy to have the mechanisms of information be so one-sided. And now we're seeing with WikiLeaks and we're seeing in this election that this one-sidedness has gotten completely out of hand. And what I mean by that is we have reporters for the Boston Globe and the New York Times sending articles to Hillary and the Hillary camp to read before they're published. And they invite, they solicit from the Hillary camp to edit news articles that are then promulgated as news. We now have all kinds of underhanded dealings between the media and a political campaign. CNN just fired somebody, Donna Brazile, for feeding debate questions to Hillary in advance. Now, again, if Donna Brazile was doing this all by herself, it would be one thing. But anybody who watches CNN can see everyone on CNN is for Hillary. Probably Donna Brazile thought, I'm just reflecting the popular will over here. Everyone's for Hillary. Let's help Hillary. That's what we're doing anyway. What's the difference if we give her a question beforehand? So what I'm getting at is this is a real problem. And the distortions of history are nothing more than of a piece with the distortion of what is going on in America even now. Even now. So now it's time to talk a little bit about Trump and the Clintons. And Trump and Hillary specifically. You know, interestingly, the two parties decided to go in opposite directions. The Republicans decided, at the end of the day, to go with the outside guy. And the outside guy inherently is going to be, politically, a wild man. A wild man. Remember, no outside guy has made it to the presidency since Eisenhower. And Eisenhower was the supreme commander of World War II. So in picking Trump, the Republicans kind of knew that they're getting a man with a lot of question marks. So why would they do it? I mean, why would they go for a guy like Trump? And the answer is, the Republicans have figured out that with this disproportion of forces of media, Hollywood, and academia, it doesn't matter if you nominate St. Francis. In fact, the Republicans did. From a personal point of view, Romney is about the most clean-cut guy in America. You can vet him all you want, and you won't even find an unkind word the guy has ever said. He's essentially a Mormon's Mormon, i.e. a super nice guy. But even so, the left is so powerful that they were able to make Romney look like Lucifer. And so the Republicans basically said, to hell with it. If that's the case, we may as well nominate a guy who has a hint of Lucifer, but nevertheless knows how to throw a punch, and nevertheless is going to challenge the existing parameters of thought and orthodoxy which need to be shaken. And that includes the parameters of thought at Bowdoin College. To get a good education, you need to know the most powerful counter-arguments to the things that you already believe. So who is the progressive? What do progressives consider to be progress? The simple answer of it, and this is supported by the history of the progressive movement, is for progressives, this isn't some vague, we're trying to make society better, and if you're opposed to it, you're against progress. No. Progressive means centralizing power in the federal government and putting us, i.e. progressives, in charge of it. So essentially, progressive means politically, turn over power to us. We'll run things better if we are in charge. That's what it means politically. Who's a conservative? What do conservatives want to conserve? Well, the short answer is what conservatives want to conserve is the principles of the American Revolution. Now, this is a very odd thing because America's origin is revolutionary. And so it is a paradox that American conservatives are conserving a revolutionary tradition. But they are. They are. And conserving the principles of the American Revolution means conserving three types of freedom: economic freedom, political freedom, and freedom of thought and religion. The most controversial of those, economic freedom. Progressives don't believe in it because they believe that economic freedom is subordinate to other types of freedom. For example, progressives are very happy to undermine economic rights in the name of, say, civil rights, or in the name of giving someone basic autonomy. But in the slavery debate, Abraham Lincoln defended economic freedom as the most basic type of freedom, overriding even the others. And his reason was really simple. Economic freedom, he said, is the right for the person who makes the corn to eat the corn. It's the most fundamental of all rights, the right to keep the fruit of your own labor. And for Lincoln, slavery was primarily a form of economic theft. So he contrasted economic freedom, keep the corn that you make, with slavery, which is basically take the corn that some other guys made. The essence of slavery, according to Lincoln, is you work, I eat. And that operating principle that you work, I eat, has now become kind of the economic maxim of the Democratic Party. In the sense that the Democratic Party is very happy to take corn made by one guy to give it to another guy and take full credit for it. The taking of the credit is what is particularly galling, because consider something like Hillary's proposal to have free college, which was kind of echoed by Bernie too. Well, you're free college. A very appealing idea, to be sure, but we all know, and the president who's here knows for full well, that education isn't actually free. Look at all these buildings, they have to be heated. They have to be maintained. Look at all these facilities. Look at all these professors driving nice cars. They have to be paid. So education isn't really free. How do you give people free education? You don't. It's not free. You just mean that somebody else is going to pay. But who? Either you're going to take it from one guy and give it to another guy. In short, make someone do what they would never do of their own, which is pay for someone else's education. If you went to your neighbor and asked him to pay for your kid's college education, see what he says. So you have to force him. Well, if he won't do it, then the country has to pay, which means you have to borrow because the country's in debt. And since we're $19 trillion in debt, we're going to add to that debt. But who gets the debt? You do. The debt is a baton that our generation is going to blithely hand over to yours. So the debt represents a claim on your future earnings. And any government program right now that spends money is essentially reaching into your back pocket, taking money that you will earn in the future, and giving some of it to you now in the pretense that it's doing you a favor. It's not doing you a favor. It's your money. But Hillary's point is, if I do this, if I steal, it's not robbing Peter to pay Paul, it's robbing Paul to pay Paul, i.e. you, and counting on you to be such a sucker that you haven't figured it out. And so the point about this is simply this. At the end of the day, the Democrats want you to be grateful to them. The Democrats gave me a free education with my own money. So politically, the gratitude goes to the people who are essentially pickpockets, who are essentially taking from one guy and giving it to another guy. Now, what really gets me is that this is done in the name of social justice. Because the one thing I learned in confinement was that when you begin to look up close at these characters, very little of what they do is actually motivated by anyone's welfare other than their own. And this is true in spades of the Clintons. Let me give a couple of examples of what I'm talking about. So when Hillary Clinton became Secretary of State in 2008, very mysteriously, Bill Clinton's speaking fee instantly quadrupled. It was $150,000, pretty much in line with Bush or any other ex-president, and it mysteriously escalated to between $500,000 and $750,000. This is to speak for 20 minutes. Now, you have to ask, who is paying for this? If you want to know what Bill Clinton has to say, you just have to watch him on YouTube. It's the usual Bill Clinton pablum. Nobody who's paying Bill Clinton for a speech is actually paying for a speech. In fact, in most cases, if you follow it, it's a down payment. The people who are giving the money, it's the government of Morocco, it's the government of Qatar, it's some Russian oligarchs who want something. They want something, and so they invite Bill Clinton to give a speech. But the speech is an effort to make a connection, and the person wants something that is worth to them far more than $750,000. It's typically worth hundreds of millions of dollars. So in a specific example, a group of Indian billionaires wanted the United States government to back the India nuclear deal, which Hillary was vociferously against. Bill Clinton is invited to speak in India. He collects all these speaking fees. Interestingly, as soon as he did that, Hillary changed her position and came out in favor of the India deal, which is what the Indian government wanted, and then tens of millions of dollars flowed to the Clinton Foundation. Step one, step two, step three. Now, I could give you, and if you'll give me time, I happily will, 10 examples of this. And we're not talking about America. We're not talking about Goldman Sachs wanting a tax break. That would be bad enough. We're talking about foreign governments, foreign entities that are essentially paying for changes in American foreign policy. And the remarkable thing about the Clintons is they admit it. They admit step one. They admit step two. They admit step three. Their point is that step one and three has nothing to do with two. They took the money. They changed the policy. They took a whole lot more money. But the taking of the money is not why they changed the policy. Now, believe me, if you tried this in any other field, like insider trading, it would never work. And as far as the FBI is concerned, it doesn't work. And the FBI wanted to investigate the Clinton Foundation, at which point the Obama Justice Department under Loretta Lynch said, no, we're not doing it. James Comey, by the way, works for Loretta Lynch, and Loretta Lynch works for Obama. So what we have with the Clintons is something that is actually, I believe, different than Obama. Obama's an ideologue. He has an ideological vision. We can agree or disagree. That's what he believes. With the Clintons, it's somewhat different. This is more like Bonnie and Clyde. These are people who have been running rackets since the Arkansas days. I just remember a little scene from the last days of the Clinton White House. Again, a little too soon for you. But in the last days of the Clinton White House, this is in around 1999, 2000, early 2001, the Clintons were doing three things. Renting out the Lincoln bedroom every single day for cash. Number two, going through the White House, through the corridors with an aide and literally stealing stuff out of the cabinets and off the walls. Norman Rockwell paintings, emptying out curio cabinets, dispatching huge shipments to Chappaqua. The Secret Service had to go to Chappaqua, get that stuff and bring it back by force. And three, selling presidential pardons for money. The Clintons put out this was before my time, or I would have put in a small bid myself. But what I'm getting at is they put out the word that if you had a conviction for racketeering, tax cheating, felonies, you need to let us know what you are willing to pay. And all kinds of people put up a whole bunch of money, and pardons were granted on that basis and are known to be. So none of what I'm saying to you tonight is in the slightest way controversial in the sense that there is an issue about whether it occurred. It is only controversial as to whether you think it's a big deal, whether you think it's okay. And what I'm saying is it's not okay. I mean, we've had crooks in America before, but we didn't know they were crooks in advance. We found out. We threw them out. With the Clintons, we know. We've also had a lot of corruption in America. Let's be honest. Tammany Hall in New York, the Daily Rackets in Chicago. But those were at the local level. I don't know a single example. I mean, first of all, I don't know a single example of a major presidential candidate a few days before the election who is under criminal investigation. I think one of the privileges of being a Democrat this year is you get to vote for a candidate under criminal investigation. You'll be the first in American history to do that. But above and beyond this, it has never been the case in American history that any Secretary of State has ever, to my knowledge, been even accused of renting out American foreign policy. Now, if what I'm saying to you seems a little bit like, what? Let me back up for a minute and give a single fact that I think puts all this in perspective. The Clintons, according to Hillary, were dead broke in the year 2000. Now, although reviled at the time, this statement is actually true. The Clintons were dead broke in the sense that if you listed their net worth, it was exceeded by their legal bills. Their legal bills, admittedly, caused by Bill Clinton's sexual harassment of Paula Jones, for which he had to pay $800,000 in ransom payments, so to speak, to make her go away. And the Clintons had racked up legal bills due to their Whitewater scandal. So yes, they were dead broke. But somehow between the year 2000 and now, the Clintons have gone from dead broke to a net worth exceeding $200 million on a government salary. So let's think about how that's even possible. How do you do that? I mean, it's one thing if you invented the iPhone or started a business, but they didn't do either of those. So how do you accumulate books and speeches doesn't even begin to get to these kinds of numbers. How do you actually accumulate that kind of money? How? Now, why do I tell you this? What is the significance of this? I'll try to bring this home and conclude. It seems to me what the significance of all this is this. Most of us who live or have lived in other countries know that most of the world is run by gangs. It's run like a gang. If you saw the movie Slumdog Millionaire, you'll know what I mean. The slums are run by gangs. The country is run by gangs. Venezuela is run by gangs. Cuba is run by gangs. And the United States has been, in a sense, refreshingly free of this kind of contaminated politics. We haven't had it. Trump? Wild man? Sure. But it's one thing to be a wild man in your private life. What you said on a bus 10 years ago. Most of the offenses I've been talking about are offenses against the public trust and the public treasury. And that means that they're not stealing from unwitting Trump University students. They're stealing from the taxpayer who's actually entrusted them with this huge pile of dough called the Federal Treasury. And these people have been looting it. They've been looting it. So to me, that's really what this election comes down to. I wish we had third choices and fourth choices. And I talk all the time to these guys who are like, never Trump. On principle, I'm not voting for Trump. And what I say to them is, listen, in politics, there is no such thing as a principle floating in the air. When I joined the Reagan White House and began to work on foreign policy, I thought the world was divided into good guys and bad guys. And I thought, this is great. It's going to be so much fun fighting on the side of the good guy. And I realized right away, no. Most of the time, the world is divided between the bad guys and the really bad guys. And now you have a conundrum. What do you do? Is it permissible morally to ally with the bad guy to get rid of the worst guy? Is the choice of a lesser evil nevertheless an evil that we should not countenance? But remember that America did ally with the bad guy, Stalin, because another bad guy, Hitler, posed a greater threat at the time. And so we realize when we get into the world of politics that you are not dealing with a world of good choices. You're dealing with a very flawed world in which often ambitious and sometimes megalomaniacal people, that's what drives them to compete in that arena and take all that's involved with it. And that's our choice today. But to me, if the Trump door is marked unknown because it has all these question marks, what would his foreign policy be? How would he deal with Putin? How would he deal with this? And how would he deal with that? The Hillary door is marked unknown crook. And so it's, to me, not a hard choice to decide at this moment of American history which way to go. Unhappy though I might be with the... My wife and I were married by Rafael Cruz, Ted Cruz's dad. We stayed out of the primary. But here we are with actual choices, and so there's no third choice. You kind of have to go with what's in front of you. I'll close with this. At the end of the day, to me, the Republican Party is the party of the latter. Now, does the government have a role? It does. To hold the latter. And that means to secure rights. How far you get in life is going to depend on luck and you. You climb the ladder. The Democratic Party, or the progressive movement, is based upon a different idea. And that is the idea, I'm going to call it the idea of the rope. The idea of the rope is to depreciate the ladder. Ladders are illusory. There aren't so many ladders in America. Don't you know many people don't even see a ladder? And so the Democratic idea is there's a tall building. They're on top of it. You're down here. They're going to let down a rope. Your job is to hold on to the rope. Their job is to pull you up. A very appealing idea, I must say, especially to a guy like me from the outside, because ladders involve work. Holding onto a rope seems a lot easier. Some other guy's gonna pull me up. But then it dawns on me, you know what? This isn't quite so nice after all, because first of all, I'll never have the earned achievement of knowing that I did anything. They're pulling me up. And number two, I'm always gonna be beholden to the guy with the rope. If he lets go, down I go. And three, the most telling point of all, looking around, I happen to notice that a lot of people who have been pulled up by the rope have never been pulled all the way up. I notice that they get pulled up a little ways off the first floor and the second floor, and then the people with the rope hold. Hold. Why? Because that's the way to keep them dependent on you. That's the way to get 90% of the votes of the people who are hanging onto the rope. Because if you pull them all the way up, they might dust themselves off and go, gee, thanks a lot, guys. See you later. But you can't have see you later. The whole point of the rope is to have these guys always dependent and always poor. We've had a war on poverty now for 50 years. We've spent trillions of dollars on it. If we just carved up the money and gave it out, none of these people would be poor. They'd in fact be richer than you and me. But somehow they've remained poor. And not only do they remain poor, but there appear to be no remedies to ever get them out of it. There's no one even proposing anything to do that. So here's where we are in America. We have academic privilege, we have success, but we also have these horrible urban plantations in Detroit, in Chicago, in Oakland, which are a moral blight on the country. And we have to admit, are entirely run by the Democratic Party. In these places, you won't even find a Republican anywhere. And so for me, this election is a tough election. It's been a dismaying election, and it's been strange in many ways. But it's not a hard choice at the end of the day, because you always must choose between existing options. That's how you live in the real world. You can never say, I'm going to, on principle, perform an action, let's just say not vote, in which the other guy wins and then proceeds to subvert your principles. That is actually using your principles in a very suicidal and foolish way. principles are judged by their actual implementation in the world of politics. So let's remember that. I want to thank you for inviting me, and I'd be delighted to answer any questions you have. Thank you very much.
Check, one, two.
Yes, Mr. D’Souza, thank you for your talk. You have, if I understand you right, you're saying the choice in the election is primarily between somebody who's very corrupt and a wild person. But I was wondering if you could speak a little bit about other policies or other issues, particularly about Russia. The people on the left and the right have demonized Vladimir Putin. And yet, for the last 5 or 6 years, he's reached out to the West, and we've rebuffed him. We've shoved NATO down his throat. Donald Trump is the only one who's saying, whatever his flaws, I can work with him. So I'm thinking Donald Trump will help us prevent World War III. Could you address that particular choice?
I think a good way to try to understand foreign policy is to at least provisionally try to see the world through the eyes of the other guy. And so if you look at Putin's world, Putin came up in an age in which the Soviet Union was essentially co-equal with the United States as a dominant world power. If we think of the great sweep of history, at rare moments in history, like the Roman Empire, you had a single dominant power. Most of the time, the world has been multipolar. Many countries vying for supremacy. Think of the 19th century. Britain was probably the top dog, but France was very powerful. Germany was very powerful. So you had these countries jostling for power. In the 20th century, we've had the remarkable phenomenon of the United States and the Soviet Union dominating the world. And that was Putin's world as he came of age. And then, almost mysteriously, without World War III, he saw internally the Soviet Union collapse and become, in a sense, a virtual third world country with very little significance in the world. No one really cared what the Soviets thought, and no ability to create or hold an empire, which it did previously. It appeared to just let it go. So to me, what's going on with Putin is that he is trying to, in this new era, post-Cold War era, restore Russian power and prestige. That is his agenda. And he believes that in Russia, there is an acceptance and a taste for an autocratic style of leadership that is, you may call it, Caesarian, in a reference to Julius Caesar's idea that I can mobilize the people against the elite. And that's why Putin actually rallies the ordinary Russian who sees him as a symbol of Russian strength and pride. Although here in the West, we see him as an autocrat, a tyrant, a kind of a rough guy, which he is, all of those things. And so the question becomes, how do you deal with that kind of guy? Now, the reason that this is not, I don't think, a great mystery is that the world is full of that kind of a guy. They may not be as strong as Putin, they may not have 1,500 nuclear warheads to point at anybody, but that is the actual, you may almost say, resume of most people who run the world today. And we're dealing with them all the time. Much more difficult for us to deal with are rival ideologies that are fundamentally incompatible with modern American constitutional democracy. I'm thinking, for example, of an Islamic radical who says, I'm doing this because I believe in Islam. We're tempted to say, you're not really a Muslim. This guy's been raised a Muslim. Everyone else thinks he's a Muslim. He prays 5 times a day. And here you have Mullah Obama and Mullah Hillary lecturing real Muslims about the fact that they're apparently not Muslims. This is like downright nuts. I mean, when in world history do we presume to lecture people on whether they are true members of a particular faith? Not only are they Muslims, but if you look at the World Value Survey or the Pew Research Studies, you see that significant minorities, I'm not saying a majority, but significant majorities of Muslims worldwide are sympathetic to what these people are doing. They're sympathetic to the Muslim Brotherhood. Hamas, as you know, won a free election. So these are not people without constituents. What I'm getting at is this. I don't know how to deal with Putin. The whole Syria situation is extremely complicated. I think it is very bad for American foreign policy that our allies in the region have one by one been knocked out. Mubarak was our ally, he's gone. Gaddafi wasn't our ally, but he was doing business with us, he's gone. Assad is in power, the mullahs in Iran are not only in power, but they're stronger than ever, and we're giving them money. So American foreign policy, I think, has been a disaster in the Middle East. And the effect of Obamaism has been that, you know, when Obama came to office in 2008, nothing could happen in the world without the United States having a big say-so. We were at that level of dominance. And today, all kinds of stuff is going on in South America, in the Middle East, in the Far East. Nobody consults the U.S. Nobody cares what we think. And in fact, they're right not to care, because nothing we say matters. And this has happened in 8 years. This is the colossal failure of Obama's foreign policy. So I don't know what Trump would do, but I think what he would do would be better. With regard to Hillary, all I can say is that no matter what your politics, no matter what country you're from, take heart, because if you want a change of policy in the Hillary administration, just remember to bring large suitcases of cash.
So you're saying that Trump would be better specifically with Russia to calm things down and prevent World War III, and Hillary would be more likely to heat things up and cause a shooting war with Russia. Is that what you're saying?
Yeah, it's not even, I'm not predicting World War III under Hillary. I'm simply saying that what we've seen under Hillary, look, Hillary has been Secretary of State. She traveled 3 million miles. And so I ask, what trouble spot in the world did she simmer down? What problem did she solve? What peace conference did she even hold? What memorable speech did she even give? And the answer is, no one can say. And I'm not talking about the guy in Santa Monica interviewed by Jay Leno. If you interview Democrats in Washington, they can't say. So what was Hillary doing all this time? Why did she set up a private server if not to conduct a private foreign policy? This stuff takes a lot of trouble, as you know, and anyone who knows anything about classified information, this is not just a matter of, I think I'll use my own account. You are briefed regularly. You have to go into a highly secure room. You've got to get your aides to collaborate. You've got to take out devices and sneak them out of the room in order to do this kind of stuff. It takes a lot of work. So what I'm saying is, with Hillary, I see a blithe indifference to the national interest. With Trump, he might get it wrong, but I don't doubt that he's a patriot and he will try to fight for the national interest, and that's what we as Americans should want.
I have a quick question. You're talking about kind of, you know, Trump is like a question mark and Hillary as like, you know, a known crook. But just to kind of like ask you a question, who's to say, like, I mean, one of the questions, as like a person raised in a conservative family, like it's definitely dismaying to think that these are our two options, but who's to say that Trump's like as an unknown, like as you're claiming that he is? Like, it seems like we do know a fair amount about him, and that, you know, Hillary has certainly rigged kind of the political system, but Trump is certainly, as it appears to have rigged the private sector, you know, and the legal system, kind of many bankruptcies, you know, things like that. A lot of bad stuff's come out around there. So who's to say? And, you know, even with his policy, kind of, he says like repeal and replace Obamacare, things like that. To someone who's a conservative, that's like, well, who's to say he's just not saying, well, the rope they're holding is not as good as the rope that I'm going to give you, as opposed to I'm going to get rid of the rope and give you back a ladder.
Well, let's start with the fact that Trump is more in the tradition of JFK and FDR, who are rich guys who got rich long before they got to the presidency. In other words, no one would say of Trump, he's running for president to make money, right? He has a lot of money. Now, number two, when you're in the private sphere, it is not fair to hold you to a standard that asks you to behave as a political person and live up to political standards that are not the law of the land. Let me give an example of what you mean. Let's say you're a liberal, and you believe that the tax rate is too low. It shouldn't be 39.5%, it should be 70%, in order to have social justice. My question is, what rate do you actually pay now? 39%. No one would dream of asking you to pay 70 merely because you advocate 70. You obviously mean that at some future point you'd like everybody to pay 70, and then you'll be happy to pay 70, but since the rate is 39.5, that's where you're going to pay. Now think about Trump. People say, Trump condemns Chinese labor, but he hires Chinese laborers to build his buildings. Well, there's no inconsistency there. That's a guy basically saying that the working class is being hurt by having too much low-paid immigrant, often illegal immigrant labor. But we have that labor now. No one stopped it. And so the question becomes, as a private citizen, should Trump unilaterally say, of all people, I as a developer, even though other developers are doing it differently, I'm in effect going to pay the 70% rate? That's ridiculous. Nobody makes that claim of anyone in private life. Nobody says that because Warren Buffett advocates a higher tax rate, he should pay one now. He isn't paying one now. He takes advantage of every tax break he can get, and his progressivism is not in doubt. So, to answer your question, Trump's offenses are not offenses of a public man. They're merely a private guy using the system as it is now, which you would do, and I would do. If there are bankruptcy laws, wouldn't you take advantage of them? I would. Why wouldn't you, if they exist? So what he's doing is perfectly legal. And so to hold it against him as a political or moral fault, because in theory he advocates other types of bankruptcy laws, I think his point is very valid. Well, Hillary, if you thought the bankruptcy laws were so bad, why didn't you advocate changing them? So that's where we are in that debate. Okay? Yes, let's go to this side.
So this program was advertised as freedom of speech and race and something else, I think. So I was hoping that you could speak more on race. Knowing that your experience does not reflect the experience of other people of color, what has been your experience as a person of color in the United States?
I've been familiar over the last couple of years with some of the debates at Bowdoin about multiculturalism, ethnic sensitivity, race. And I thought to myself, I was scratching my head and thinking about this talk as to whether I should talk about that. I mean, talk about multiculturalism and racism and focus on those topics, which have been the body of my life's work. And I think that's actually what I spoke at when I was here last, was I talked about foreign policy, but also about race. The reason I focused on the Democratic Party here is I wanted to highlight that this is what racism actually means. Now, I'll say that because let's talk about Trump. Trump calls some guy a Mexican. Not a nice way to talk. The guy is an American of Mexican descent. I am an American of Asian Indian descent. If you were to call me an Indian, I might be a little annoyed, but it doesn't make you a racist. It makes you insensitive. But insensitive is not racist. Racist is an ideology of inherent supremacy. We've actually had racism in America. Part of the measure of the degree to which racism has declined is the fact that we now discuss as racist things that have never been considered that, and actually have nothing to do with the ideology of supremacy that is at issue here. In other words, it is inherently the case that when people are very different, you get all kinds of prejudice that is based on not knowing the other person. And so you say things that are dumb. You haven't considered the other person's point of view, which is a failure of empathy. But anyone who thinks that that is racism has no idea what racism actually means. So here's what racism actually means. Here is actually one of Bill Clinton's mentors, Orville Faubus, the longtime governor of Arkansas, standing in the Arkansas schoolhouse and blocking black kids from getting into the school. That is racism. That's based on a whole ideology of white supremacy. And it's remote from Trump. Trump's a New Yorker. He doesn't know anything about any of this. Bill Clinton and Hillary, they know all about it. They're a big part of it. Robert Byrd was a longtime member of the Ku Klux Klan. He was called the conscience of the Senate, knowing this. When Robert Byrd died in 2010, again, not ancient history, we're talking about 6 years ago. Obama went to his funeral. Bill Clinton went to his funeral. You think that they would say, oh, we've just got to be a little careful here about endorsing old Robert Byrd, because this guy was, after all, in the Ku Klux Klan. Robert Byrd, in his memoir, says it was the grand dragon of the Ku Klux Klan who spotted his talent and convinced him to go into politics. The grand dragon of the Klan. Now, Bill Clinton addressed the fact that Byrd was in the Klan, and he said this. He goes, don't be too hard on old Byrd for being in the Klan. You had to be in the Klan in order to advance in the Democratic Party. You had to be in the Klan. Think about that. And this is 6 years ago. So here's what I'm saying. What I'm trying to say is, here we are, Bowdoin College. We've got this diverse body of students. We have to learn to get along. And you have to learn to talk to each other. But it can't be a one-sided discussion so rigged with political correctness that everybody's walking in a political minefield in which you can't actually speak your mind because you're under immediate indictment for being a racist. You can't do that. That makes no sense. So to me, a lot of the racial outrage has to be measured against the proportion of what was done. And when I do that, time and time again, I find it's fake. And what I mean by fake is not that it's not, people aren't outraged, it's that they have worked themselves into a frenzy. Why? Because of the joys of moral supremacy. In a debate, it's always good if you can at the beginning say, I am the absolutely pure white good guy, and the other guy is an absolute monster. Because then you have him up against the wall. You can get whatever you want, and all you actually demand is apologies. So that's not a real debate. And so all I would say, I haven't discussed a single specific incident, but all I would say is that in today's climate, let's keep in mind proportionality. This is racism, and this is stupid stuff that you shouldn't have said. And there's a big difference between those two. And there's a way of handling it. If some guy says stupid stuff that he shouldn't have said, that's not a reason to destroy his career. That's not a reason to make him go down on his knees and apologize to the whole campus. We don't need witch huntery as a solution, much worse than the original problem. So, bottom line of it, I'm very alert. I mean, all my life, I'm alert to expressions of insensitivity, bigotry. Look, I've been on the most right-wing quarters of the Republican Party. The Reagan administration, the Hoover Institution, and if there is racism anywhere in America, I would have believed it would come there. And so I was on the lookout for it. Obviously, now I realize I was looking in the wrong place. Racism has been the natural home of the Democratic Party. So obviously, I shouldn't expect to find it in the Republican Party. I probably should have strolled over to the DNC and tried to read their emails. Because there's a whole lot of bigotry there. And one more point about that, new bigotries. Bigotry against Catholics. Bigotry against evangelical Christians. So let's keep things in perspective. People say, we want to have a diverse campus. Really? Okay, how many outspoken evangelical Christian professors are there at Bowdoin College? As compared to the surrounding population. How many outspoken professing Catholics are there on the faculty that are outspoken in their views? So to me, this diversity game is a little bit rigged. The college, there's so much emphasis on racial diversity, gender diversity, transgender diversity, and the most important kind of diversity, intellectual diversity, a little bit scarce. So what kind of diversity is it that undermines the real diversity of thought? Let's look at this. Look at all the people who say they're for the working class. Everywhere I go in the Ivy League, we're for the working class. You know who the candidate of the working class is in this election? It's Trump. The guy who's actually speaking to real working class anxieties is Trump. And so if you think that Trump is this abominable monster who should be run out of town and not even allowed to run, but he's representing the very people that you claim, I don't claim, you claim, to sympathize with, something is totally wrong with this picture. So think about that.
Okay, so I think that I disagree with your definition of racism, but I also wanted to point my question, or direct my question more about your own experience in the United States. And if it's like, if you don't want to talk about it, I understand, but it would be nice.
My experience with racism is that America is a country that has made a huge amount of progress and change. And that racism today is episodic rather than systemic. Racism used to be systemic, by which I mean pervasive and supported by law. I don't think anyone reasonably can claim today that our laws are racist. And racism itself is so infrequent in the circles that we move in. It's not infrequent in other circles. For example, look at all these incendiary confrontations with cops. I contend that there's a lot of racism there, but it's not what people think. You come to my own experience, no, I've been fortunate to live in the rarefied sectors of American life where racism is very rare. I would be, as I go through years of my life, I would be hard-pressed to find individual examples of prejudice. Obviously, there are all kinds of people who ask me about India and do elephants walk on the road and that sort of thing, and I don't. That to me is not racism. That is basically called you need to get out more phenomenon. And so the fact that an American isn't cosmopolitan, that he doesn't know my culture, that I know more about America than he knows about India, none of this is even remotely racist. That being said, the country has changed. The new forms of racism to me are much more dangerous than the old. They're much less visible. It's not just the white cop. It's that what you do is we've created an inner city situation where growing up gives you PTSD, because broken families, no education, no opportunity, no ladders, and a very bad rope. And then we send in cops and go fix that. This is no more than sending an overseer into the old slave plantation and saying, go fix it. The problem is not of his making. He didn't create the plantation. There's inherent violence on the plantation, and the overseer can take out his whip, and he can do this, and he can do that, but at the end of the day, it's the inherent violence of the plantation that's the problem. Here, too, the Democrats have created unlivable living spaces called inner cities. It's really hard to grow up there, and you have no life, and you're going to take it out on the cop because he's the guy who comes in with a gun, but it's not his fault. He didn't make the situation. And so this is kind of the conversation we need to have with Black Lives Matter. Black lives do matter, but they matter in a more complicated context than we often are willing to admit.
Thank you for speaking tonight. What do you say to a young person whose views on social values don't align with those of the modern Conservative Party? Even if I don't distrust big government, how can I support a party who, in my view, denies some groups of people fundamental human rights?
Be more specific.
The right to marry who you love, the right for a choice of a woman's body, common sense views on climate change that will affect generations to come, like important stuff.
Okay. So let's think this through a little bit more. Climate change. Granting the premise that climate change occurs. There's a partial debate over what is the actual cause, i.e. humans or nature. And number two, what is it that we can actually do that will remedy the situation appreciably. A question not often considered is, if the Earth's climate has warmed, let's say, 2 degrees in the past 100 years, and would warm another 2 degrees in the next 100 years, are there actually strategies that would be more reasonable to deal with climate change and adapt to it than to try to adapt the climate to us. Think about it. You go into a place and it's really hot. You don't think to yourself, how do I turn down the sun? You think to yourself, maybe I should take off my jacket. That's called adapting yourself to the climate instead of trying to adapt the climate to you. It's a little easier, right? So the question then becomes, when it comes to climate change, is this a reasonable debate? Now, this is not my area, so I'm not going to go down this road. I'm just thinking out loud. And that's just a way of saying that the criticism of the climate change movement is not per se unreasonable. It's simply asking, when you're talking about something like the Earth's climate, it is your obligation to specify very precisely what is it that we can do to appreciably influence that. If you were to say, let's dramatically change our standard of living, and we can affect the world's climate by a half a degree over the next century, then it's a very reasonable question of whether the world's population wants to do that. And no climate change policy is reasonable that doesn't at the end of the day seek the consent of the governed. It's not enough to say that you think it's a good idea, so let's make it happen and force it on the world. You have to make the case in the public arena. This is a democracy. You have to get people to agree with you and vote for you. Okay, climate change. The other issues are complex, and I'm not going to try to resolve them in any way, except to say that on all these issues, there is a counter-argument. And all I would plead for at this point is, let's hear it, even in situations, even in settings. And again, back to the racism issue. If you advocate a position and somebody has a counter-argument, you can't declare it out of bounds at the outset. You can't say things like, I'm advocating this position, but whatever you say is going to offend me. And it's going to make me feel really uncomfortable, and therefore you don't get to say it. Or you're automatically on the defensive and I get to beat you up because you're disrespecting me. You can't have a debate under those premises. No one's going to agree to it. That's not a fair starting point for an engagement of the argument. I'll give you one thought about the abortion. You mentioned abortion. Okay. In the Lincoln-Douglas debates, Douglas argued, people, communities, territory, states should be able to decide for themselves if they want to have slavery. He goes, I'm not for slavery, but I'm not against it either. Americans disagree about slavery, so we have to agree to disagree. Let each community decide for itself. Now, I don't know if you realize this, but this is the exact pro-choice position, except transferred from states and territories to the individual. The individual should decide. Now, Lincoln had a counter-argument, which is worth considering. Lincoln said, choice is very good, but it depends on one thing, the content of the choice. So you can agree to choose if you want to have higher taxes or lower taxes, but you can't agree to choose whether to enslave another guy, because you're agreeing to choose to deprive that guy of choice. That is not allowed. That was Lincoln's argument. I would submit that is the pro-life argument today. That choice, sure, depends on what you're choosing. Now, you can choose, and your choices are unlimited, but you can't actually choose to take some other person and deprive them of all their life choices. I'm basically going to decide you're going to have no life. And so all the choices I'm making right now, you don't get to make for your whole entire life. What's the difference between that argument? In fact, arguably, the pro-life argument is stronger than Lincoln's argument because enslavement is merely a deprivation of freedom, whereas we're talking about a deprivation of life, including freedom. So what I'm getting at is, there we go. I've just made an argument. And I might be right, I might be wrong, you may agree, you may disagree, but what I've said is not inherently stupid. So what I'm saying is that in an academic community, you need to hear this and you need to think about it and reflect upon it, and reflect upon the historical resonance of these arguments we have today, because they're not fait accomplis. It's not obvious that one side is right or the other. My fear about the conservative argument isn't that young people reject it. They don't know it. They haven't heard it. And this is kind of the reasons why I like to speak on campus, is it's at least advancing for consideration ideas that are often not given respectable intellectual currency in the very place that's devoted to the intellect. Okay, any other questions? The mic, I think, is making its way.
I don't know how many people in this room know the story of Trump's rebuilding of the Wallman ice rink in Central Park during the 1980s. If you don't, look it up. It's a perfect example of the difference between private sector capability and government capability trying to achieve the same thing. It's just an unbelievable case. Secondly, with respect to your comment about Trump actually being the person of the working class, I happened to go to a Trump rally here in Maine this past Friday, and it was 1,200 people or so in this gymnasium, and that was the way I described it to my friends when I got back. It was a cross-section of working class America to me. I was really pretty surprised, considering it was a work day, too. So these people made it up there. Just an observation.
Yeah. Now, I do want to say as a conservative that I think at the end of the day, a successful political movement cannot be a movement without elites. It does need educated people. It needs lawyers. It needs politically sophisticated people, people with foreign policy experience. And so to me, one of the unfortunate developments in the Republican Party is the way that the Republican elite and Trump have been at loggerheads. It's very unfortunate and not necessary at all. What you said about the private sector and the public sector is very true. If a private sector healthcare executive had said 3 years ago, I'm introducing a new type of policy under, let's just say, Kaiser, or I'm introducing it under Scripps, and this is going to make you pay $2,500 less in premiums. And if you've got a doctor that you like, you can keep it. And if it turned out 2 years later that this was a flat-out falsehood, that it was not true that you could keep your doctor and that your premiums, far from going down $2,500, went up $2,500, that person would be immediately investigated for making false statements to customers, misleading the consumer, essentially for consumer fraud and untruth in advertising. Now notice that this is exactly what's happened with Obamacare. The whole idea is it's going to lower costs, it's increased costs. With lower premiums, it's increasing premiums. And we're not talking about marginally, we're talking about massive escalations for people who have no choice in the matter. And yet, no one even calls for anything. In other words, there's no sense that the public figure is going to be accountable in any way. There's no price for flat out lying. If tomorrow Congress turns around and says, you know what, all you people who have been paying into the Social Security system, no Social Security for you. It's completely legal. They could do that. Now, no one else can do that. If the Vanguard Index Fund, which has my retirement account, were to say, you put all this money in here, you know what, we're taking it. You don't get it. Immediately, I would demand that those people be locked up. But with the government, it's a different set of rules. And so this is why I think, as young people, we don't recognize that the government has coercive power. And as a conservative, I got to tell you, my eyes are open in all kinds of ways. I used to think basically that people who are locked up were locked up because they must have done something really bad. Not really true. Not really true, unfortunately. I used to believe it's better that 9 guilty guys go free than 1 innocent man be locked up. I hate to tell you, all kinds of innocent people are locked up right now. This is the real America. And so part of my politics and the way it's changed is it's become much grittier about being willing to look at the world in the eye, not so much the way I want it to be, but the way it is and what to do about it now.